alternative. What if we had said we won't buy?
Tonight, joining host Al Smith on Comment on Kentucky is Aubrey J. Wagner, chairman of the board of the Tennessee Valley Authority.
We're glad to... Good evening. We're in Bowling Green, Kentucky, on the campus of Western Kentucky University, talking to Aubrey Wagner, who is chairman of the board of directors of the Tennessee Valley Authority. TVA buys about a fifth of all the coal that Kentucky produces, doesn't it, Mr. Wagner?
I expect that's about right, yes.
And perhaps two-thirds of all the TVA uses comes from this...
80% of the coal we use comes from Kentucky.
Kentucky.
70% of it from West Kentucky.
What is TVA's service involvement with Kentucky?
Well, we provide power for about 19 counties in Kentucky, but power, of course, is just one tool in our kit of resource development tools, and we have other interests, too. Seven counties in Kentucky are actually in the watershed, and there our regular programs go on as they do in other areas. For instance, Kentucky Dam, which is here, provides flood control for the city of Paducah and on down the Ohio and Mississippi River. It's been very helpful in the past in controlling floods. We have two power generating stations, one at Shawnee and another at Paradise, coal burning stations. Our Land Between the Lakes recreational program is a really significant development in TVA. Kentucky is a major participant in that, of course. One of the things that interests me about that is its environmental education features. We've had about 25,000 students, most of them elementary school students, and 2,500 teachers trained there through the years, and it's a tourist attraction, of course, about 2 million visitors a year. That's significant, I think. And also, Kentucky participates in our agricultural and fertilizer use programs, largely through the Agricultural Extension Service of the University of Kentucky. There are new fertilizers tried on farms and new farm practices conducted by county agents working with TVA materials. There are, I think, about a dozen fertilizer plants in the state of Kentucky that use TVA processes for manufacturing their fertilizer.
Well, I guess still the big question that you get these days is, what is TVA doing in the management of its power services about electric rates? What are you doing to slow down the rise in electric rates?
Well, we're doing everything we can. In our internal management, for instance, we're producing a kilowatt hour of electricity today with about 20% less man hours than it took 5 years ago. We have gone to the newest type designs of power plant production facilities. We've gone to high voltage transmission to hold our costs of transmission down. Our nuclear effort is, of course, one aimed at reducing our costs. Nuclear power, we think, will prove to be about 40% cheaper than coal burning power from coal burning plants, or perhaps more. And we have made every effort that we can to hold our costs down. Now, to understand the power rate business, you have to understand what goes into the costs. And for instance, in the current fiscal year, the fiscal year just passed, our costs amounted to a little over $1 billion. A little over $500 million that was for coal and fuel and power imports, which replaced fuel. The balance of it was distributed between money, the cost of money, borrowed money, depreciation, labor, and other things. But one of the significant things is that in the past year, the increase in our coal costs over the year before was $226 million. Mm-hmm. The increase in all other costs was only $82 million, so that the increase in fuel costs was nearly three times the others, and it far overshadows all of our costs.
So when you're talking to a Kentuckian who asks you about what you're doing to keep the costs down, you also have to say, well, I'm trying to keep I want the coal prices to stay down, and you all mine a lot of coal in Kentucky.
That's right.
So
we
The coal boom here is a mixed blessing as far as we're concerned, because we're paying for part of it in our electric bills. Is that right?
That's correct. When you pay your electric bill, about 50 cents of what you pay, we have to pay to the coal companies for the coal that we buy. Out of every dollar.
Can you give us any idea when this spiral of rate increases will peak out?
Well, of course, the power rates will follow the general inflationary pattern, either up or down, as far as labor goes and interest costs and so on. If inflation continues, the power rates will go up. The big question in what will happen in power rates is what happens to our fuel costs. Now, as I say, the last year, our average cost of coal burned was about just under $9 a ton. Mm-hmm. This year, it's going to be closer to $18 a ton, nearly double on the average. And that includes the effect of long-term contracts that we have underway. If you look at just the new contracts that were awarded during the past year, they're about $24 a ton, or nearly three times our average cost a year ago, and a third higher than our average cost the current year. If the average cost should go to $24 a ton, for instance, that would add another $6 per ton, or $240 million a year to our costs, which is about a 25% increase. To answer your question as specifically as I can, the future of power rates depends largely on the future of coal costs. We recognize that mining coal is tough business, it takes a lot of money to do it, and that coal producers must earn a fair profit. But we have some coal reserves of our own that are being mined for us, Al, and so we know about what it costs to mine coal under varying conditions. And we believe that under current conditions, a cost of $10 or $12 a ton will get the average coal out of the ground and provide maybe a 20% return on the investment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you compare that with the $20 to $24 or $25 a ton we're paying, it appears to us that the profits that are being taken are excessive. And what worries us is that our job is to get those dollars out of the pockets of the consumers. And we just pass them on to the coal companies.
Mr. Wagner, one problem that has been voiced to me by people back home is that when they tried to reduce consumption earlier this year and last year, particularly during one of the coal strikes, they found that just saving consumption wasn't going to keep the rates down. And now we hear that it's more a matter of economic conservation, supposedly, rather than saving conservation. In other words, that just not using power isn't going to keep our rates, get our rates any lower. Isn't that correct?
Well, that's right. Of course, if you use less power in any given month, you're going to pay less for it than you would if you used more. There's no two ways about that. So conservation is important to save money. But in the long run, what you have
to
pay...
The rates went up anyway.
Yes, but the rates went up for other reasons. Mm-hmm. The rates went up because the price of coal went up. I mentioned those figures on mm-hmm. recent years. Just about 3 years ago, we were paying $4.50 a ton for coal. So that the big reason for the increase in rates is the increase in the price of coal in our system. In other systems, it's the price of oil, and they're catching it even worse than we are.
Well, what are your electric power objectives? Well, can we look forward to being told that we, for instance, might get a discount if we used our washer and dryer at home at night instead of in the daytime to meet a different load demand? Or that we'd do better by spending more on electric appliances that didn't consume as much electricity?
Well, our electric power objectives, Al, are to furnish the power that the people of the region need at the lowest possible cost. And if we're examining our rate structures now, and if we find ways that will really save money for the consumer, we will certainly put them into effect. You're mentioning peak load pricing, I think.
Yes, sir.
Well, now, we have to remember that our basic problem now is not a capacity problem. It's a problem burning energy, burning coal. And if you heat your water, say, at night mm-hmm. instead of in the daytime, it might save some generating capacity, but it will burn more coal, require more coal to heat it, because your water will cool off some, so that you don't really save energy. Those are things that have to be looked at. Now, it could be that on balance, peak load pricing would prove economical, but so far it hasn't looked that way.
Do you see a shifting away from industry rates where industry might get a higher charge, for instance, than it did in the past, and the consumer rates might be adjusted differently?
Well, we believe that so far at least, we're convinced that each kilowatt hour that's used, whether by industry or in a residential area, ought to pay the cost of providing that kilowatt hour, that neither should we try to subsidize industry with our residential rates or vice versa. You see, if you drive your industry rates up in this area, what you would do is to drive industry from here to other areas where the rates are lower. If in the nation as a whole we should raise our industrial rates, we'll drive our industry away from our shores and to other countries and increase our imports. And this...
Of course, there's hardly any place they could go where they're any lower right now.
Well, our rates in the Tennessee Valley are the lowest in the United States except for the Pacific Northwest, that's right. And they're substantially lower and that margin's increasing. And we intend to keep it that way.
You mean this report that the gap between TVA's rates and other rates is closing, you say that's not so?
That's not true. That's correct. In the last year for which I have seen a record, I think that's, I forgot whether it was 73 or 74, our rates were, 74 it was, our rates were about 1/16 cents per kilowatt hour on the average, and they had increased 0.4 cents. The rates in the rest of the country were 2 8/10 cents a kilowatt hour, and they had increased twice as much, or 0.8 cents in a year. And that gap is increasing. The Edison Electric Institute turned out some figures that I saw a few weeks ago, which indicate that there are $4 billion in rate increases pending for private utilities now. Their problems are, as I say, even worse than ours, because many of them are dependent on oil, and the price of oil have gone up even more than the price of gasoline.
I didn't mean to get you in a contradiction, but we've still got one out hanging. That is, that if you don't adjust the rates, you were concerned that an adjustment of rates on industry might drive industry away, but at the same time you say that our rates are still lower in the Tennessee Valley. But you don't really want to change the way you're pricing to industry and residences, do you?
No, we don't, because the differences in industrial rates are less sharp than the differences I gave you, which were for residential rates. In any case, we think that it's a mistake to penalize industry, charge them more than it costs us to provide the service, because this decreases the industrial opportunity in the area, it decreases employment, it decreases jobs.
You're still trying to create jobs in this area.
We are going to have, in the United States as a whole, I think 70 million more people to provide jobs for by the end of the century, and it's going to take energy to do that. Don't misunderstand me, I think we've got to conserve energy in every way we can, but I think it's a mistake to say we have to just chop it back at the expense of jobs or at the expense of health, or really at the expense of hard labor for our women in our households. These young girls who are growing up, they want washing machines and dishwashers and clothes dryers. They don't want to go back to the scrub board and the backyard
fence. Of course,
there
was a time when you were really trying to sell everybody in the valley a washing machine and an appliance in the promotion of the use of electricity.
That's
back
right.
In the 60s.
That's right.
TVA's distributors have moved away from that, though, now, haven't they?
Well, I think recognizing the fact that there is currently a fuel shortage that we face, and there could be a capacity shortage in the next 10 years, particularly because many utilities across the nation have in recent years, in the past year, have canceled their plans for building new capacity. They just couldn't finance it. So that we need to conserve more than ever now. But I think that our job is to see that we get the kind of energy that is available, affordable, and environmentally acceptable to the people to meet the needs that they really have, their genuine needs. Now, you said that a while ago you said that our conservation needs to look towards more efficient utilization of energy, better buildings, better insulation, more efficient appliances, outside the electricity field, more efficient automobiles and so on. And that's true. That's the opportunity for the big saving. And we need to push research in all fields. We need to find more economical ways to generate electricity than we have now.
Mr. Wagner, over in the western part of the state, where you've been involved with the development of the land between the lakes, I get the question occasionally, or hear the question, why does TVA, which had this primary mission, or a major mission of producing electric power at a cheap rate and flood control, with the involvement of TVA and other activities such as the LBL and recreation and town lift and so on, building model cities, how much does this affect the pricing of electric power to consumers, which who presumably make part of the profit for TVA? In other words, by our use of electricity, do we support and subsidize TVA's recreational programs and land development programs?
No, not at all. The answer to your question is that it affects electric rates not one iota. Mm-hmm. The money that's used for the programs other than power is all appropriated by the Congress for those activities here as it is in other areas, and kept, it's not charged the power program at all. The two activities, our general resource development activities, are accounted for and financed entirely separate from the power program. Revenues from the power system are used only to pay the cost of the power operation and to reinvest in plant in the system to help build generating plants and transmission lines and so on.
So what TVA is doing in the LBL area in Kentucky has not one thing to do with the price that somebody in Hopkinsville or Bowling Green or Glasgow pays for electricity.
That's correct, not one thing.
Mr. Wagner.
At the beginning of that question, Al, you said TVA's primary purpose was...
I should have said one of its primary purposes.
Yeah, its primary purpose is really to help the people of the region develop their resources, all of them. Mm-hmm. In ways that will help them to build a better quality of living. And power is just one of those.
Mr. Wagner, as chairman of the board of TVA, you are hitting, I guess, the largest electric utility in the United States.
That's correct.
When you've been called on to as a consultant all over the world and to help build power systems for developing nations. And you're also seen now at the close of your career, or at the last, in your second term as chairman, you're seen also as the architect of TVA's increased reliance on stripped coal, or surface mined coal. And Congress, 20 years ago, liked your coal burning plans well enough to authorize TVA to build a series of steam generating plants to produce electricity to keep pace with the mushrooming requirements of this seven-state region that you've been serving, that you have served. Because of the tremendous fuel requirements you had, TVA, it seems to me, became the kind of the godparent or godfather of the strip mining industry. Two decades later, many conservationists who once championed the agency are enraged over the effects of stripping. They say that you've changed directions and that you've made TVA, that your policies have helped make TVA into a mammoth corporation which subordinates all other considerations to low costs and a balanced budget. Then the coal industry in Kentucky dishonors, at least some of the segments of the industry have dishonored some of their contracts, delivery contracts to you. Then they've priced you, you've said in effect at the beginning of the program, higher or at a cost that you think is excessive, with profits that you believe are excessive. And the rates that we're getting as consumers are much higher than they were. Now, how do you hope to mediate your course between those who fault you for the abuse of strip mining and then the coal suppliers who seem to have you over a barrel at times and the consumers who don't want to pay more for their rates?
Well, Al, you put about 4,000 questions into one here, and I don't know whether I can answer them all, whether I will.
How do you see yourself setting a course for the next few years?
Well, let me back up for a minute, if I may, to the past. Now, you said that I or TVA was regarded as the architect of strip mining.
Now, you were general manager of TVA when you all set this policy, and Congress approved it.
That's right. Well, I won't dodge responsibility, accept the part of it that is mine. But let me point out that for TVA to have refused to buy strip mine coal, which many people have suggested, wouldn't have affected the problem affirmatively at all. The coal would have been strip mined for others anyway. Now, what TVA did was to try to get strip mine reclamation accomplished even before we began buying coal. And we had strip mine demonstrations going in the 1940s, before we were buying coal, before we had our first coal-burning plant. We were promoting legislation, state legislation, to provide strip mine regulation when the people who are now decrying strip mining were either asleep at the switch or off somewhere else looking the other way. I was a lone voice before the state of Tennessee legislature at one time asking for strip mine control. We're the only coal purchaser in the United States, that, as far as I know, to require reclamation of the coal land that is strip mined for us. I think for us to have turned our back on it would have been to have avoided a responsibility that was ours. We have tried by example, we have tried by urging to get strip mining regulated and controlled and get the land reclaimed. We recommended to the president that he sign the bill which was vetoed in Congress and which failed in
And that was a wholehearted thing as far as you all were
concerned. Yes, that's right. We honestly believe that land can be reclaimed and should be reclaimed. If it can't be reclaimed, it shouldn't be strip mined. But I think for us to have said we just abandon this fight, we turn our backs on it, is chickening out, and I don't like to do that. The land would have been strip mined anyway. The coal would have been taken. I think that by joining the fight, we have helped to get strip mine control and reclamation earlier and better than it would have been achieved otherwise. Now, we've taken an awful beating for it, as you've pointed out.
You've lost some of your early friends, you know.
Yes, I think that's right. But I think we've lost them because they don't understand what we're doing. And I wish they would look at the alternative. What if we had said we won't buy strip mine coal? Do they think that no one else would have bought it? They certainly would have. And the coal that we have bought since 1965, the land has been reclaimed where otherwise much of it would not have been reclaimed.
Have you all done anything that you would say was comparable to the in land reclamation and insisting on land reclamation that was comparable to the forest and agricultural development projects in TVA's first decade in the 30s or 30s and
Well, 40s? There are different kinds of programs, but yes, we've applied, well, our strip mine reclamation program is administered by our foresters. Mm-hmm. And we have made numerous efforts.
Now, this is reclamation on your lands, on lands owned by
TVA.
Yes,
but it's on demonstrations. Mm-hmm. There, our foresters in charge of our demonstrations and the land that's owned by us, too, or not the land that's owned by us, but the land that is strip mined for us. But we have also made numerous attempts to get appropriated funds from the Congress to do a reclamation job on all the orphan lands in the area. We've never got to the Congress with it. We haven't got past the Bureau of the Budget.
Well, now, if for someone to supply you with surface mined coal from lands that are not leased by you or held by you as coal reserves, you insist that they too reclaim the lands that from
yes.
which this stripped coal comes,
yes,
as
we
well
do.
As land that is stripped that TVA owns or has leased for
That's
coal
correct.
Supply.
That's correct.
Well, in terms of the your relations with the coal industry, another part of that question, you've expressed yourself already as believing that some of these prices that were charged to you were excessive. I trust that a request you made to Congress to use its subpoena power and investigate this pricing may, in your mind, be an action that you've taken in terms of your relationship with the future relationship with the coal industry, but it's not going to make things any better for you, is it, for a while? In other words, you may have pleased the consumers with the third part of my question by asking for an investigation as to why you're having to pay so much for coal, but you haven't done anything to ease your own relationship, the agency's relationship with the coal suppliers themselves.
Oh, perhaps not. We buy a lot of coal and they've got coal to sell. And our obligation is to the consumers in the region.
Right.
We've raised the question as to whether the control of a major part of our basic energy resources, coal, oil, gas, uranium, in the hands of a few large corporations is in the public interest. We think that that ought to be investigated, it ought to be aired, it ought to be understood. This is extremely vital to our whole economy, to our way of living in the United States. We must have energy to move.
Could TVA have filed some antitrust suits early on in this, when coal began to go up, suing the oil companies or the coal companies?
We've examined that question very carefully. I've had our legal staff do it, and we have not been able to find the kind of evidence that you could use to bring action against them. Now, I don't think that there has to be a collusion on price fixing. You know, if there are a dozen or so major organizations that are providing your coal and they all start going up on the price, they don't have to get together and agree on the price. The price just goes up, that's all. And the thing that concerns me now is that the price bears no reasonable relationship to the cost of producing it, as near as we can tell. And I think for something that's as vital to our very life in this country as energy is, that relationship should be there.
Was there any pressure on you from the White House not to bring suits when you were looking at it?
No. Our attorneys have discussed this with the Justice Department, and the Justice Department has felt they didn't have a basis for bringing action any time yet, anyway.
That was primarily when John Mitchell was Attorney General in the Nixon White House.
I think our general counsel has discussed it with the Department of Justice more recently than that, within the past few weeks.
Mr. Wagner, two other environmental matters dealing with air pollution and nuclear power. TVA is supposed to be a yardstick, a demonstration agency. Why can't TVA meet the clean air standards of the state of Kentucky and the federal agency charged with protecting our environment? I know you've been in this fight a long time, mm-hmm. and I think still the public questions TVA's almost defiance, at least, or refusal to comply with what the state and the EPA have asked you to do about sulfur dioxide emissions.
Well, you understand, ultimately, we will have to comply, and we will comply with whatever the law requires us to do. And while we may not be subject to state law, we would comply. Mm-hmm. But our feeling here, again, is that we have a primary responsibility to the consumers, and we believe that we're something of a demonstration, a testing ground. We interpret the Clean Air Act as requiring that the air be kept clean at ground level, where people live and breathe. And we have developed a method for doing that, using tall stacks and low sulfur coal and weather monitoring and so on, that works. We've tested it at the Paradise plant in Kentucky for 5 or 6 years, and we know it works. And we can do that at an annual cost of about $17 million. Now, the EPA feels that the law requires that the amount of sulfur dioxide that you put up the stack, the emissions, be limited continuously. And in order to do that, they've proposed a different program which would involve scrubbers and coal washing and so on that would cost, we think, about $170 million a year. Now, it won't make the air any cleaner at ground level. It won't meet the ambient standards any better, and we agree the ambient standards must be met. But that's the position we're arguing now. And as you know, the state of Kentucky originally did permit the use of this alternate strategy that we have. Then EPA frowned on it, and so they refused to approve it. So the state changed. The matter is now being argued, or will be argued, before the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals. If they decide that that we have to put in continuous emission limitations, well, I guess we'll have to do it unless the law has changed.
You don't have any intention, ultimately, of not complying with the law.
We will comply with the law, whatever it is. Now, let me say, if we think the law does not make sense in the consumer's interest, we will present that viewpoint.
Thank you for being with Comment on Kentucky. This is Al Smith from the Clear Power. One question. You are fairly convinced in your mind that you're on a safe course in increasing your reliance on nuclear power in the future.
We're completely convinced. This matter has been argued for years, and the great bulk of scientific opinion says that the nuclear plants are as safe as they need to be, safer than most things
Aubrey
that we do.
Aubrey Wagner, thank you for being with Comment on Kentucky. This is Al Smith from the campus of Western Kentucky University saying thank you and good night.